Welcome.
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 Welcome to Belgrade Online.
Welcome to Belgrade Online.
Welcome to Belgrade Online.
Welcome to Belgrade Online.
Welcome to Belgrade Online,
an online ministry of Belgrade Avenue United Methodist Church.
Well, good morning, Belgrade Avenue Church, and anyone else who's with us right now. I'm Dan Crandall. I'm the pastor here at Belgrade. Thanks so much for joining us this morning. We're so glad that you've decided to be with us today. And our prayer is that you'll encounter Jesus more deeply and be inspired to live into his kingdom in new and beautiful ways. Well, hey, if you're joining us for the first time this morning, would you do me a favor? Could you send a quick email to baumc@baumc.org? That's our offices. We'd love to send you a small gift just to say thanks for joining us today. And be sure to include your first and last name and your mailing address. And don't worry, we're not going to bombard you with any junk mail. We just want to send you something to bless you in a small way. Well, hey, a couple quick announcements as we get going today. Tomorrow is our monthly Second Harvest food distribution, and we're giving away fresh produce like we do every month, and we'd love for you to come help and join the fun. We meet in our church parking lot at 10 a.m. for setup, and we usually run from 10:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. or so, and the more the merrier, so come on down and join us. And next up, we've been talking about it for a couple months, and it's finally here. Our Triple Church Vacation Bible School starts tomorrow, Monday, June 14th. And it's going to go through Friday at First Presbyterian Church in Mankato. And the programming each night runs from 6 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. But if you bring supper for you and your kiddos, you can come and hang out for supper together at 5:30. So if you know someone who would like to go to VBS but has not signed up yet, there's still time. Sign them up today. And if you or someone you know would like to help out, you can quickly still sign up to be a volunteer before the day is done as well. So to do that, you can head over to our website and click on RSVP under the Compassion Camp image, and you'll be able to put your info in right there. So we're looking forward to being able to bless our kiddos this summer and get back to VBS this week. Hope to see you there. And that is all I have for announcements today. Well, wherever you are right now, would you do me a favor and bow your head and let's pray together. Let's pray. Holy God, thank you so much for another week. Thank you so much that it's not winter. Thank you for this weather. Even though it seems to be a bit hot, we thank you that it's not freezing cold. And so we thank you for everything that you're doing in our lives. Lord, wherever we are right now, I pray that you help us to calm our minds and our hearts and help us to shake off whatever's going on throughout the week and whatever we've been through and just meet us right where we're at. And I pray this morning, Lord, that you would reach into our lives to touch our hearts, give us clarity of thought and clarity of mind, and transform us and give us the seeds of transformation this morning. And I pray that, Father, that as we go through this morning, that you would continue to help us to be aware of your presence, that spirit that is ever abiding and never leaves and never forsakes. So I pray that this morning, Lord, and I pray for transformation to happen. And whatever is in your heart to do, I pray that that would be done. So we thank you, Lord, and we thank you for this morning and for all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
And I'm Aaron, and we'll be doing your shout-outs this week.
Hey, it's summer vacation.
Yes!
Let's get to it. Our first shout-out is a belated birthday shout-out, and it goes to our district superintendent, Rev. Dr. Pastor Evangelist Doctor Fred Vanderwerf. Yeah, his birthday on June 8th. Happy birthday, Fred, from Belgrade Church. Our second shout-out goes to Bruce Burnett, who has his birthday on June 13th. Bruce, we pray that you make this year your best yet, because he likes to make stuff. So happy birthday from your church family.
Next shout-out goes to Chris Bowler, whose birthday is on the 14th.
Hey, she makes stuff too. Delicious food.
Oh, that sounds awesome. Well, hey, Chris, hope you have a fantastic birthday.
And maybe some delicious food.
And happy birthday from all of us to you.
Shout out to Cody Donovan, who also has a birthday on the 14th. Cody, dude, have a rocking good birthday. And just climb up through the whole next year. So happy birthday from Belgrade Church. Hey, we got a lot of birthdays on the 14th. Must have been something on the water.
I got a couple more too. Happy birthday shout out to Nancy Roberts, who also has her birthday on the 14th.
Oh, I love Nancy. She gives the best hugs ever. So up her.
Yeah, we're big Nancy fans around here. We all love you, Nancy. So happy birthday, Nancy, from your church family.
Last one for the 14th. Happy anniversary shout out on the 14th, of course, to John and Brenda Holm. 46 years. What a great couple. Those peeps know how to live in the moment.
Amen.
Happy anniversary, John and Brenda. You're special to us, and we pray that this is your most greatest, wonderfulest, bestest year yet.
Shout out to Amber Gabrick, whose birthday is on the 15th. Amber, we pray that you have a meaningful birthday, and that it comes with a lot of joyful stuff. We hope you have a chance to have a party.
A what?
A party, because she owns a puppy grooming business. Get it?
I don't think that joke worked.
Oh well, I tried. So happy birthday, Amber, from the church peeps.
Shout out to Jenny Robbins, whose birthday is on June 15th. Jenny, we hope all is well, and we pray that your birthday is super cool. So happy birthday from us to you.
Shout out to Kevin and Susan Black, because their anniversary is on June 15th. 36 years. So have a happy anniversary, Kevin and Susan, from the church family. Make this year the best.
Shout out to Warren Anderson, because his birthday is on the 16th. Warren's the coolest dude ever. I bet if you put that guy in a leather outfit, he can scare away all the bad guys.
Mm-hmm.
But seriously, happy birthday, Warren. Enjoy your birthday week. The church family loves you.
And our final shout out goes to Joe and Stan Stokesbury, because their anniversary is on the 18th. 61 years.
I think that's the same age as my parents.
Yeah, mine too. So happy anniversary, Joe and Stan, from Belgrade Church.
Oh man, that was a lot of shout outs. We did it. I gotta replenish my electrolytes. Where's my Gatorade?
If you have a shout out you'd like us to include on Belgrade Online, send an email to our office, and we'll be sure to, Pastor Dan, what are we going to do again?
Hey, we could get a dinosaur and walk him down the street.
What does that have to do with shout-outs?
Don't know. Just always want to hang out with the dinosaur.
Sweet.
Last week, we began a short 3-week mini-series called The Roundabout Way, And we talked about the fact that the journey that is our lives is not linear. We tend to look at the journey of others, whether online or just through hearsay or by hearing stories with lots of details left out. And even though we know better, we think that others' path is cut and dry, straight and easy. But that's an illusion. In reality, our trajectory isn't start here, now draw a straight line, and now we're here. Usually, it's a mix of crazy loops and twists and turns, and we go straight ahead for a bit, then curve left and end up 10 steps behind where we were when we started, and around we go. And we talked about the frustration that comes when it seems like the thing that we'd expected to happen so soon seems to take forever. And we think, man, by this time, at this point in my fill in the blank, career, relationships, marriage, finances, whatever, by this time in my life, I should be further along by now. But God is doing something unique in your situation, in our situation. So we looked at God's people after being delivered from slavery in Egypt in a dramatic way and how they were on their way out of there fast and they were headed toward freedom. And their dream of having a place of their own, a land flowing with delicacy and abundant beauty, was right at their fingertips. And then they spent 40 years in the wilderness of the Sinai Peninsula. And the kicker was when we looked at a map and noticed that the route they took, that took them 40 years, was not the only route from Egypt to where they were headed. There was a main trade route that was more direct. There was a main trade route that was commonly traveled, and if they'd have taken that route, it would have taken them less than 30 days. What would have taken them less than 30 days took them 40 years. But in that time, God completely transformed them. And the scriptures say in Exodus chapter 13, verse 18, that God led the people by the roundabout way of the wilderness. The roundabout way of the wilderness. When our trajectories don't look straight, when they take longer than they should, just like ancient Israel, God may be leading us the roundabout way. Because sometimes God doesn't just desire to change our circumstances. He desires to change our hearts. We want God to stop the suffering and eliminate the hardships and remove the pressures. But he's endeavoring to change the condition of our hearts. Because remember, it took one night for God to take Israel out of Egypt. But it took 40 years to get Egypt out of Israel, to change their thinking and their ideologies and their culture and their hearts of the entire nation. Sometimes we want to change in our circumstances, but God wants a change of our hearts. So now today I want to talk about what to do in our wilderness seasons. What do we do when life seems to take so long? How to navigate life in the roundabouts. So that's what we're going to talk about today. But before we do that, let's go ahead and pray and hear our scripture reading for this morning. So would you join me and let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for this morning. I pray, Lord, that you would speak to us, that your spirit would speak, Lord, that through me, that my words wouldn't be my own, but that your spirit would speak and that we'd hear you and that we'd have eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts that understand what that spirit is saying. So we ask that in that process, you would mold us and shape us and form us and transform us into who you've created us to be and who you're developing us to be. And so we thank you for this time. Have your way in Jesus' name.
Today's scripture reading comes from Psalm chapter 105, verses 7 through 22. He is the Lord our God. His justice is seen throughout the land. He always stands by his covenant, the commitment he made to 1,000 generations. His people didn't count for much in the beginning, a mere handful of people, and strangers at that, wandering from country to country, drifting from pillar to post. Then a famine came upon the country. Every last blade of wheat was broken. But he sent a man on ahead, Joseph. Sold as a slave, they put cruel chains on his ankles, an iron collar around his neck, until God's word came to the Pharaoh, and God confirmed his promise. God sent the king to release him. The Pharaoh set Joseph free. He appointed him master of his palace and put him in charge of all his business, to personally instruct his princes and train his advisors in wisdom. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, the first time I went to London, I was with the Christian band and ministry that I traveled with in the very early 2000s. And I was absolutely fascinated when I got to London with the roundabouts there. because there hadn't, you know, yet been any installed in the parts of the U.S. that I had lived in up until that point. And so in London, every time we went through a roundabout, it reminded me of that scene from the movie National Lampoon's European Vacation, where Chevy Chase and his family are driving in London for the first time, and they get stuck in this roundabout and can't get out of it. And just in case you don't know what I'm talking about, I want to show you that short one-minute clip. So here it is real quick. Check it out.
I guess what we do is just drive around this circle here. It should be the second left exit. There's the hotel. Hey, look, kids. There's Big Ben and there's Parliament.
There it is.
I know. I can't seem to get over to the left, honey. I'll try next time. Sorry. We'll get out of this jam in a minute. Kids, Big Ben, Parliament again. Kids.
We know Big Ben.
Parliament. Look, kids, forget it. It's amazing. I cannot get left. There's Big Ben, kids, Parliament. I don't know.
So when we were in London, whenever we'd go across the bridge over the River Thames, I would start quoting that scene. You know, I'd say, look, everyone, there it is, Big Ben, Parliament. You know, and by the end of the week, our whole team was saying that. And I remember seeing that movie on TV when I was a kid, and I wouldn't recommend watching a version that's not the TV version, by the way. Definitely not as clean. But that particular scene always makes me laugh, which is why I remembered it. But it also makes me frustrated because it reminds me how much I hate roundabouts. And I feel much safer at a stoplight than feeling like I have to compete like a gladiator to get over into the right lane just to get out of the doggone thing. You know, because if you don't make it over, you're stuck in orbit for God knows how long. You know, but of course, the scene from that movie is familiar to all of us. Not just because it seems like nobody likes roundabouts, but rather because we know the scenario in that clip all too well. You know, we enter into an intersection, subconsciously assuming that we're going to exit to the other side while moving swiftly to our destination. But instead of getting through, we seem to get stuck. And we go round and round. And we grow tired of seeing the same old sights, and tired of talking about the same things and going through the same experiences over and over again. And of course, I'm not talking about driving through an actual roundabout. I'm talking about the wilderness seasons in our own lives. And like we mentioned last week, Scripture is full of stories of people that were led this roundabout way. We mentioned Abraham and Sarah, who were promised a child of their own, a son of their own, but it just didn't seem like it ever happened. And every circumstance seemed to make God's promises more and more unlikely. And they waited years. And Jacob, who wanted to marry Rachel, ended up getting caught in his roundabout for 20 years until that dream was realized. And we talked about David, who was anointed king as a teenager, but didn't actually take the throne until 15 years later. And in our scriptures today, we heard about another character who was led through intense many seasons of the roundabout way. So today, I want to look at the life of Joseph. And now in our scripture today, it recounts a sort of a summary of Joseph's story from the Psalms. But the actual story of Joseph's life is found in Genesis chapters 47 through 50. It's way too long to read. So I settled for this short scripture, but great synopsis instead. But I want to give you a real quick refresher on just everything Joseph went through in his life. Because in those chapters in Genesis, you know, there's lots of stories in the book of Genesis, a lot of strange stories and a lot of just kind of normal stories. But Joseph's story is by far the longest chunk of scripture in the book of Genesis, the longest story. And so it's interesting that this story takes up that much time. And many of you are familiar with the Joseph story, whether it's from scripture actually or whether it's from, you know, the musical that kind of is based on the scriptural story. But the actual story begins when Joseph is 17 years old, and he was his father's favorite. He even had a special colorful coat just in case anyone else needed reminding that he was his father's favorite, you know. And he has this series of dreams where he becomes a ruler over all of his siblings, which I'm sure didn't help matters at all, especially that he told them about those dreams. And so his brothers grew super jealous and throw him into this empty well. They just want to get rid of him. But then they decide to pull him out and sell him to some merchants who are passing through. And so they fish him out of this well and they sell their brother into slavery. And Joseph is now a slave, traveling somewhere he does not know with people he does not know. And he ends up being taken to Egypt and was bought by the captain of Pharaoh's Egyptian guard. He's bought by this guy named Potiphar. And the scriptures say that he found favor in the sight of his master, this Potiphar. And this guy put Joseph in charge of everything in his house, caretaker of his possessions, overseer of his affairs, foreman of his jobs, manager of the other slaves. Things were looking up for old Joey. You know, but then Joseph, who's a good-looking dude, and Potiphar's wife had a bit of a wandering eye. She figures little old Joe was a good slave, so he would obey her just as much as he would her husband, the master. So she tries to seduce Joseph. But Joseph exercises an incredible amount of honor and self-control and refuses her advances. So, out of sheer jealousy and self-hatred and fear of getting exposed, she makes up this yarn, this tale, this story, this false account of Joseph and tells everyone that he tries to assault her when it was really the other way around. And of course, Potiphar, Joseph's master, the, you know, this woman's husband, believes that his spouse is telling the truth. So he instantly throws Joseph into prison, just when things are looking good for him. Now, even though he's done all the right things, he finds himself sitting in prison, shackled again. Again, Joseph finds favor with his superior, this time the chief jailer, and he becomes the second in command of the jail as a prisoner. And so pretty soon, a few more people show up in his jail cell. Two guys happen to work for the king, the reigning Pharaoh himself. They show up in this as prisoners in this cell. Pharaoh apparently got mad, and in his rage, he threw these guys into jail, unwarranted. And so long story short, Joseph indirectly helps one of these guys out of prison. And when this guy is released, Joseph says to him, "Hey, remember me so I can get out of here too. Put in a good word for me, you know." But the scriptures say that as soon as this guy leaves, he forgets all about Joseph. And now Joseph, full of hope that this guy that he just helped is going to let Pharaoh know the truth so he could be released, starts to wait. And Joseph waits, and he waits, and he waits. For 2 whole years, sitting in jail, for 2 years waiting. Think about it. His brothers just beat him up and throw him in a well. Then they fish him out of the well, but not to free him, to sell him. And so he's sold into slavery, not once, but again, it gets sold to another person. So he's sold twice as a slave. Then after working hard to gain favor, a woman comes at him, he declines, then she lies about him and gets thrown into prison. Then after helping another guy in prison, he promises to put in a good word to the king and get Joseph out of here. But then he doesn't. And Joseph ends up waiting 2 more years. That is a roundabout way. Now, I'm sure Joseph went through many cycles of grief during these times over his tough situation. Every time something starts looking up, things start looking good, something or someone happens that comes and takes him out again. I'm sure Joseph went through periods of anger and frustration, lament, tears, clenched fists, clenched teeth, gritted teeth, sleepless nights. You know, he was human. But one thing we know is that Joseph submitted himself to the grief process, but in the process, he didn't allow himself to grow bitter. Because when you don't submit to your grief, but instead you try to fight it, push it away because you're afraid of it, or you don't want to feel the tough emotions, when we do that, we end up blocking the healing process. And eventually, over time, a person that does that will grow bitter. And when bitterness takes root, it's really tough to get it out. But when you embrace your grief, you embrace the pain, you embrace the anger, the confusion, the disorientation, eventually you'll heal. And when you do, you'll be different. So Joseph felt all the feels, but he didn't grow bitter in the process. And scripture says that he continued to, quote, gain favor at every turn. Every time life seemed to be looking up, but then found himself back in the orbit of the roundabout. In the face of every setback, After a while, he'd find himself gaining favor in the situation once again. And as we'll see in a moment, favor comes to those who have mastered the beast of their own attitudes. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not talking about privilege. I'm talking about favor. Privilege is systemic. Favor is something that's bestowed upon a person-to-person, case-by-case basis. And like we said earlier, in the midst of our own circumstances, God wants to change our hearts, to shape us, and prepare us for whatever it is that we're being led to do. So, how do we cooperate with that end? Well, our lives are like a story. And as far as we're aware, that story is still being written. And listen, we can look at the life of Joseph and see the good that all of his struggles led to. But we know that Joseph's troubles worked out for good in the end, because we know the end of his story. But we're still living out our stories. We're still in the midst of them. We're still in the middle of our own character arc, both individually and together as the entire people of God, in history and around all the globe. We can't see the future. Many times all we know is the pressure we feel in the moment that seems to last so long and bring us around and around and around and around and around again through the roundabout. But understanding the mechanics of what makes a great story can help all the difference in the midst of our struggles. Every author knows that in order to make a character change in any meaningful way, that character has to go through hell. In great stories, the more hell a character encounters, the more they change. And change is what makes a character worth tuning in for. It's their character arc, their transformation. That's what makes a story interesting. Nobody wants to watch a movie where the characters have no arc, where they don't change. Because without change, there's no story. But here's the kicker. Like I said, in order for a character in a story to undergo dramatic transformation, they have to experience a great deal of adversity. And I've mentioned this many times before. I don't believe God brings the adversity. There are dozens of reasons why bad things happen, and I don't believe God is one of them. But I do believe that once the adversity comes, God will and does use it as a tool, and he will lead us through it. He's helping us to face it and to navigate it, and to do so in such a way that we are transformed in the process. Listen, being a Christian doesn't change what you face in life. It changes how you face it. God doesn't cause the adversity, but he's down here with us. The Spirit is in the mud and the tears and the blood and the pain, helping us through it all. And if we cooperate with that Holy Spirit, she will also be molding and shaping us in the process. So what do? How do we cooperate with the Spirit, with her transforming work? Well, here's what I've found that works. A decade or so ago, I stumbled over the work of a famous psychiatrist from the last century by the name of Viktor Frankl. Now, by the 1950s and the 1960s, Frankl's theories had begun gaining a lot of attention, and there was a mental hospital in Vienna who brought him in to implement his research. So, they put Frankl in charge of their suicide division of their hospital, which was 30,000 patients. 30,000 patients. And over time, during Frankl's tenure there, not one of those patients took their lives. During Viktor Frankl's time on watch at this hospital, as he implemented his theories with them, those patients had a 100% success rate. Zero suicidal patients took their lives while Frankl was there. God sent Frankl, and he helped 30,000 patients out of their roundabouts. So what was his theory? And how can we use it in our own roundabouts, in our own wilderness periods? Well, the answer has to do with what our ultimate aim is as humans. Basically, all of humanity has one goal, one purpose that if we don't fulfill it, we'll start slowly falling apart. One need, our hearts, our psyches, our spirit, we have one need, and if that isn't met, everything falls apart. Now, Viktor Frankl had a theory about this, but so did another psychologist who you've probably heard of and know as Sigmund Freud. So Frankl and Freud both had theories about this, but they weren't in agreement of what those theories were. Viktor Frankl began his work around the same time Sigmund Freud was sort of stepping off the scene. Now, Sigmund Freud's theory was that one thing, that one aim of all humanity, that one need of humanity was pleasure. But Viktor Frankl disagreed with Freud. Frankl did not believe that the aim, the goal, the basic need of all humanity was to experience pleasure. He didn't believe that. Frankl believed that the one thing, the one aim, the one need of all humanity was meaning. And he said that without meaning, we will attempt to distract ourselves from the pain with pleasure. Without meaning, we'll try to distract ourselves with pleasure. And when that pleasure is taken away and there's no meaning to sustain us, we slowly disintegrate as humans. Frankl said, life is never made unbearable by our circumstances, but only by a lack of meaning and purpose. Basically, if we as humans can squeeze meaning out of our suffering, we can endure anything. And I mean anything, as we'll see in a moment. Joseph understood this in our scriptures. He knew what God had promised him, and God's promise infused him with meaning, and it empowered him. And that meaning sustained him through the bullying of his brothers, the injustice of his enslavement, the lies of a seductress, the forgotten promise of his prison friend, all of the hard times in the roundabouts. It's meaning that sustained him. And it's meaning that sustains us. It's meaning that sustains us in our sicknesses. It's meaning that sustains us in the midst of our failures. It's meaning that glues us to hope and helps us to hold on when our checkbooks are falling apart and our marriages are strained and we can't see clearly to find our way forward and we feel lost and the injustice of the world weighs down on our shoulders. It's meaning that sustains us in the wilderness, in the roundabouts. And if we find meaning, there's an attitude that we gain, a perspective that helps us to not only hold on, but also to cut right on through. As the song says, break on through to the other side. So how do we do it? What's the attitude we can gain? Well, Frankl said that anyone can, quote, gain a strong sense of meaning when they find something called a redemptive perspective towards their suffering. He's basically saying, in the middle of your suffering, you can get through anything if you gain something called a redemptive perspective. What's a redemptive perspective? A redemptive perspective means that in every tragedy, in every hard time, in every setback, we find something good to focus on. And then we hold on to that thing. It could be the thought of reaching a goal, you know, so we endure and persevere so we can reach it. Or the idea that our hardship is sparing someone else from pain. Or it could be the idea that our pain is serving someone else in some way. Whatever it is, it's the thing, the reason you get up in the morning and face another day. A redemptive perspective. And this gives us the hope that we need to keep on going when we're in the wilderness roundabouts. Now, listen, there's a caveat here, because there's two unhealthy ditches that we can fall into with this idea. On one side, there's this idea that we're all victims. You know, that we can never take the mentality of a victim for long term. There's a story about Desmond Tutu, when he was organizing his commission to bring healing to South Africa in the horrifying wake of apartheid. He said that he wanted victims to come and help lead. People whose lives were torn apart, who'd had their parents killed, who'd been raped, who had their homes burnt to the ground. But he said he wanted people that were victims but didn't stay victims. He said he wanted people who had forgiven their oppressors. And that may seem offensive to some, but that's the command of Jesus. If we're going to say we follow him as Christians, then it's our mandate to forgive in the midst of our suffering, before we're out of it, and love our enemies. And Tutu called these people, Desmond Tutu called these people wounded healers. So in one ditch, there's this tendency to play the role of the victim. When we play that role of a victim, we release ourselves from any resilience, any grit that helps us to get through and get up again. Like Rocky, every time he gets knocked down, he gets up again. But if we play the victim, we'll never get up. But we're not victims. We're resilient. We have power. People who have a victim mentality, we're a lot of times are victims because they're powerless. But listen, we have power. And we have a kind of a power that nothing and no one can take from us. And that's the power of our own perspective, our own attitude. So in one ditch, there's this mentality of taking on a long-term posture of a victim. Now, listen, on the other side of the aisle, on the other ditch, we can fall into is something that I call toxic positivity. It's the Pollyanna attitude, you know, oh yeah, it's tough, but God will see me through it. God will see you through it. Okay, bye, you know. Or, you know, something like, oh, well, I'm still blessed, you know, when you're deep down, you're hurting, but you refuse to admit it. You know, it's when you're at the end of your rope and in a deep crisis and someone says something like, well, look at the silver lining, at least, fill in the blank, and you just want to punch him. Listen, we don't repackage negative circumstances as positive circumstances. That's called denial. And it can be extremely damaging if we attempt to give it to others in the midst of their suffering, and if we take that posture in the midst of our own suffering, because it'll result in long-term trauma that will absolutely plague us and our loved ones through us if we ignore it. So we're not victims, but we also aren't toxically positive. Instead, we take the middle. We take the middle of that continuum. We see a situation for what it is. We feel the pain. We grieve the pain. We cry the tears. We shout in anger. We lament. We talk about the fear. We tremble at it. But at some point, we rise up and we say, you know what? I have power, God-given power, to find meaning and purpose in this situation, and I will not allow it to keep me down. God, help me understand the meaning behind this and empower me with it. You know, God, I know you didn't inflict this pain on me, but you're forming and strengthening me through it. So show me what the meaning is. Show me where the purpose is. Give me a fresh perspective. And God will show you. And you'll grow. Because following Christ doesn't change what you face, but it does change how you face it. And Viktor Frankl knew all about that because he had a wilderness period of his own. See, he'd had these ideas, this theory about meaning being the central need of all humanity. He had these theories as early as the late 1920s. But one thing I didn't mention to you is that Viktor Frankl was Jewish. And when World War II hit, he opted not to flee from the Nazis. And when they came for him, he willingly went to Auschwitz to test his theory. And he suffered through the entire war in that concentration camp. And he lived. And he made it through by finding meaning to sustain him. It's an incredibly powerful story, and he documents the entire experience in his book, Man's Search for Meaning, which I highly recommend if you want to learn more about this. Obviously, it's an outdated title. It should say, you know, Humanity's Search for Meaning, but you get the point. A redemptive perspective, meaning, a reason to get out of bed in the morning, will sustain you through your roundabouts, through the wilderness. Just like Joseph held on to the promise of God, the dream. He may not have fully understood that dream, and what understanding he did have definitely changed over time throughout his time in the roundabout. But it sustained him, so much so that he kept moving forward, submitting to the process, gaining favor in every situation. You know, God in my life, God had called me to be in ministry. But ministry now looks and means something completely different than when I started 20 years ago. Our dreams, the word that God gives us, we might not understand it in full at first. But over time, if we hold on to it and allow it to give us meaning, even if that meaning changes, hold on to it loosely because God will speak to something different to you in each phase of your journey. But you hold on to it. Because it's the meaning that gets you through it. Because being a Christian doesn't change what you face in life. It changes how you face it. So what is it for you? Maybe you're in a roundabout season right now. A wilderness period. Maybe you're weary. You're weary and ready to give up. Maybe. But don't. You have meaning. You have purpose. Dig in and figure out what that is. Because it's that meaning that will sustain you and catapult you into the next phase of your life, but transformed and stronger in Christ. Next week, we're going to close this series by looking at some ways we can jumpstart that process of finding meaning in our own lives. But your life is a story, and God's Spirit is guiding you through, forming you, and shaping you and transforming you. And if you'll cooperate with the Spirit's work in you, with how she's guiding your mind and heart, as well as your circumstances, you'll eventually find the reason for the suffering. And it'll all make sense. Being a Christian doesn't change what you face in life. It changes how you face it. Let's pray. God, we know that you don't cause all the evil that seems to come to us in our lives. But Lord, we know that you're with us. We know you said you'd never leave us, you'd never forsake us. God, in the Psalms, it says that though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we will fear no evil because you are with us. God, that doesn't mean that we think everything is perfect all the time, and that doesn't mean that we look at the silver lining when we're really hurting. God, it means that we're honest with ourselves, but at the same time, it means that we don't stay down and we don't play the victim, that we realize the power that we have to make meaning and the power that we have to allow your Spirit to build that meaning on the inside of us. So I pray, God, wherever we're at, wherever those that are hearing me talk right now, wherever we're all at, wherever they're at, wherever I'm at, wherever we're all at, God, I pray that you'd meet us there. Show us the meaning and absolutely inflame us with passion for that meaning. Help it to consume us so that instead of keeping our minds on whatever suffering or how long or it's taking to get to where it is we're going, instead of that, we absolutely submit to the process, and we envelop ourselves in the meaning that you put in our hearts. So I pray this for all of us, and I pray that you transform us as we go about it. We love you, and we thank you for all that you're doing, even behind the scenes, in ways that we can't see. In Jesus' name, amen.
Salt and light, and our love's great height.
church, would you join me in praying the Lord's Prayer together? Together we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. May your kingdom come and your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, that's all we have for you this week. Church, as you log off this morning, may you not deny your hard situations. May you not stay a victim. May you find meaning in your suffering. And may you find yourself transformed in your wilderness and in your roundabouts. Well, hey, I pray that you're all staying cool and are surviving this frigid Minnesota weather. Bless you all. Have a fantastic week. Grace and peace to you. See you soon.
Because she owns a puppy grooming.
Oh, this is gonna be fun.
Yeah.
We better be careful. These babies are late for weapons.
That was really funny.
Shout out to Warren Anderson.
Well, last week we began a short 3-week Minnesota. Okay, let's just right off the gate. Let's get it out of the way. Here we go.
Yep.
And that meaning sustained him through the bullying of his brothers, the injustice of his enslavery.